want to introduce this by telling you what happened to me when I was a teenager. There was a farmer, owned a lot of land in our community, and he had a great pond. It was he stocked it, he took care of it, and it had, you know, had the reputation of having the best fishing in the whole community. The only problem was he was really picky about who he would let fish in his pond. And so I worked for him, and I worked for him picking up hay on his farm. So I was scheduled to work for him. You know, the next day we were going to go over. It was during the summer, and I was staying at one of my friend's house, and both of us were going to go over and work for him that day. And my buddy said, you know what we need to do? We need to sneak over tonight and go fishing in his pond. He won't let people fish in his pond, but if we go over there at night, he won't know. And so I didn't feel real good about it, but, you know, it's my friend, so I went along with him. And I can honestly say I didn't fish. My friend did it, and he caught quite a good fish that night too, by the way. Caught a big bass and took it home and put it in the freezer, and later got the thing mounted. And he caught this fish, and everything's good. You know, we were over there, it's midnight, 1 a.m., 2 a.m. maybe. And the pond was in a part of his property that really was far away from the guy's house. And the next morning we get in the truck to go out to the field to start picking up the hay. And the farmer's driving. Picture it. I'm sitting in the passenger seat. My friend is sitting right between us, and we're driving out there. And the farmer says, hope you guys had a good morning. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Boy, it's a beautiful morning this morning. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Beautiful night last night too, wasn't it? Yeah, yeah, it was a beautiful night last night. He said, man, I was outside last night, and it's just such a beautiful night. And I got to thinking about how beautiful of a night it was. You know, it reminded me of when I was a boy. There was this old man in our neighborhood that had a pond that was just the greatest pond in the community. He wouldn't let anybody fish in it. And he said, you know, last night was the kind of night where me and my friends might have thought about sneaking over and fishing in that old man's pond when he didn't know anything about it. And I mean, me and my buddy were just looking straight ahead, silent. And he said it would have been a great night to do that. But you know, probably that old man was pretty sharp, and that he probably would have known we were over there fishing in his pond. And we're still silent. And he said, do I need to say anything else? No, sir. He said, all right. I think we worked as hard for him that day as we did any other day, you know. But he showed us mercy. You know, he could have gotten us in a lot of trouble. He could have made a bigger deal out of it. He could have fired us. You know, there's a lot he could have done. But he showed us mercy, and I'm thankful that he showed us mercy. And so as Jesus is teaching through these blessing statements, he comes to this, blessed are the merciful. Blessed are those who show mercy, for they shall receive mercy. Before we dive into that particular statement, I want to remind us of where we've been and kind of give us an overview of all of these blessing statements. Sometimes we call them the Beatitudes. That's a Latin word for that means blessing. And what we see in these blessing statements is that they're spiritually progressive, so they build on each other. Blessed are the poor in spirit. We started there a few weeks ago. Blessed are the poor in spirit. So blessed are those who are broken spiritually. Broken over what? Well, as we look back, especially into the Hebrew scriptures and understand the background of that statement, it's spiritual brokenness, brokenness over sin. We are sorry because we recognize and we're spiritually broken over our sin. So we're poor in spirit. Our spirits are impoverished. We have nothing to offer spiritually. What is our reward? Our reward when we recognize we have nothing to offer spiritually is the greatest spiritual reward we could possibly receive, the kingdom of heaven. So we get everything when we recognize our brokenness. Blessed are those who are poor in spirit. And then that moves naturally when we're poor in spirit. It's progressive. That leads us to mourn. When we recognize how poor we are and how we have nothing to offer, then we're led to mourning. We're led to brokenness over our sin. And, of course, Jesus tells us that when we're broken over our sin, then our blessing, our reward, is that we're comforted. And that's not just a general comfort. That's a comfort by God. God himself actually comforts us. So you can look for comfort somewhere. You can look for some kind of way to deal with the fact that you're broken, that you have sin. Or you can be comforted by the God of the universe. Those are our choices. We can't run away from our brokenness. We can't deny our brokenness. We can only see it, see that it's sinful, see that we're spiritually poor, then lead to a time of mourning. And then that mourning can lead us to being comforted because it leads us to repentance and it leads us to turn to God. So that's the second one. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. And this speaks of our, once we know we're broken, we mourn over it, then we're withholding, if we have power, we're withholding that power. We're not advancing our own selfish interest by power. Or if we really might be in a spot where we have no power. How is it that we're going to inherit the earth or inherit the land, inherit all the promises God has for his people? We're not going to do it through our power. We're going to do it because God fights our battles for us. God is going to win the day for us. God has already won the day for us through Jesus and everything he's done through him. So he's giving it to us as an inheritance. We will inherit the earth. So you see the spiritual progression that goes through these. The last one, we hunger and thirst for righteousness. We come to Christ. We're broken over our sin. We mourn over our sin. We come to Christ. We're inheriting all the promises of God. And then we have a spiritual hunger. And that spiritual hunger is filled or fulfilled in Christ himself. We actually have a relationship with God where we find all of our fulfillment because we have a spiritual hunger that we have from a relationship with him. So those first four deal really with our vertical relationship with God, this vertical relationship we have with him. And then the second set of statements 5-8, really address our horizontal relationship with other people. So then we get into the one we're talking about tonight. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. So as we show mercy to other people. And see, understand how it kind of works. We've been transformed by Christ. This is spiritually progressive. So we've been transformed by what God's done through Christ. Now we go out and we live out our faith. And it includes things like mercy. But then, as we'll see in a few weeks, it also includes verse 10. Blessed are those who are persecuted. So our horizontal relationship with other people changes because of our vertical relationship with God. And it's a change for us because now we're more merciful, but it also changes our relationship with the world. Now we're going to be persecuted. And Jesus will go on to say, one of the reasons you're blessed is because they persecuted all the prophets that were before you. Why would we think we would not be persecuted when every follower of God before us, every Christ follower that's come before us, has in some way experienced persecution? And that's just a reminder of our blessings, a reminder that like they inherited the kingdom of God, we too have inherited the kingdom of God, and that is why we face persecution. But tonight we zone in on this fourth blessing statement. Blessed are the merciful. So those who show mercy will receive mercy. We all love to receive mercy. The question is, how do we receive it? Do we force our way somehow into receiving mercy? Is there some way to twist God's arm into giving us mercy? Is there some way to power our way into getting mercy, to manipulate our way into giving mercy? Or is there this path? This is the path. Those who show mercy will receive mercy. And so we want to start with that idea first, the merciful. What does it mean to show mercy? What does it mean to be merciful? Jesus talked about this quite often. So you have a couple of passages there in your listening guide from other places in Matthew. Jesus would talk about this idea of merciful. So twice he quotes this this Old Testament passage about God desiring mercy more than sacrifice. So one instance that I have for you there in your notes is Matthew chapter 9, verses 11 through 13. So the Pharisees come and say, "Why do your teachers eat with tax collectors? Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors?" Come to his disciples. This was something that, you know, they would often ask about Jesus. So when Jesus heard it, verse 12, he said, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick." So it's not the healthy that need a doctor. It's the sick who need a doctor. "Go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice, for I came not to call the righteous, but sinners." But Jesus does few things in that statement. One thing that he does is he clarifies why it is he's eating with tax collectors and sinners. "I'm here to help the sick. I'm here to help," and really we would say, "I'm here to help those who recognize they're sick." The most spiritually sick in that whole group were the Pharisees. They just couldn't see it. So they've not gone to the doctor, if you will. They've not made the appointment. They're not looking for help. But he also does something else in there. He puts his ministry up and against the Pharisees' ministry. So not only does he explain why he's not spending time with them, you don't recognize that you're spiritually sick. He condemns them for not spending time with those who are sick, who need mercy. And so he says, in effect, you should be doing what I'm doing. Instead of asking why I'm eating with sinners, you should be also eating with the sinners. And then he roots it in the Hebrew Scriptures. He points all the way back to this statement where God says, I desire mercy, not sacrifice. You know, there was a time where God said, I wish you would close the temple doors. I wish you would stop going down there, stop making sacrifices, stop observing the festivals. Not because those were not God-honoring, designed to be God-honoring. They were. God himself prescribed them. It was because they were going through all the ritual, and then at the same time, they were looking over the needs of their brothers and their sisters. So they were trampling on people on their way to the temple. So in effect, God says, I wish you would stop, but the way you're treating your brother and your sister, I wish you would stop going to church. Shut the church down and go do what you make it right with your brother and sister. Stop treating them like they're they're dirt. And I would rather have that than you coming to the temple and doing what I've prescribed for you to do. There's no power in your sacrifice because of the way you're living your life. So Jesus quotes this verse to remind them that they should have been the ones eating with tax collectors and sinners. Now, God's not really saying he doesn't want them to go through with the sacrifices and do everything he's asking to do. What he's saying is he's saying that you've missed the point. The point is not that you can go to the temple, make the sacrifice, and live your life any way you want to live it. No, part of the point of the sacrifice is to remind you that you have received mercy from God and you've been forgiven. And so as you have received mercy, now you should live a life of extending mercy. Matthew 23, Jesus makes this statement again to the scribes, or actually about the scribes. He says, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, for you tithe the mint and the dill and the cumin and have neglected the weightier matters of the law, justice and mercy and faithfulness. Then he goes on to say, you shouldn't stop doing the latter. So you should still keep your obligation the way that you the way that the Lord has commanded you to. But you can't neglect the more important things. So we all know, if you've ever seen spices, some of you probably grow your own spices. You see how small they are. Well, they would go in their wherever they're growing these spices, and they would count the leaves. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And they would pick the 10th leaf. And so they were so concerned about getting the letter of the law right, had to give 1/10 of even their spices. So even the dill, even the mint, they're going to make sure they get that 10th leaf, and they're going to take it down to the temple, and they're going to tithe on even something that small. But, Jesus says, you have neglected the weightier matters of the law, and one of them is mercy. You are trampling the people who need mercy while you're going into your backyard and making sure that you tithe on a mint. Jesus says you shouldn't stop doing that, but you should understand the heart of the law is that you would show mercy and that you would live justly towards your brothers and your sisters. So mercy, that's what we're talking about. Jesus often talked about mercy. So what exactly does it mean? We see that it's others-oriented. We see from those examples that it's others-oriented. It is something that we do towards other people. It means to be sympathetic and compassionate. Just the meaning of the word is to be sympathetic and compassionate, to show compassion to someone else, to show sympathy towards someone else. It also indicates that the whole idea of mercy means that in some way you have something you could hold over them, or you could harm them in some way, and you don't. So it in some way indicates that you have some kind of power over a person. So a policeman pulls you over, and he could give you a ticket or he could not give you a ticket. In my example earlier, this farmer has something on us. He knows that we were there fishing in his pond the night before, and he could do something with that. He has some kind of power over us, and he decides that he's not going to. It also could imply that not necessarily that you have power over someone, but that you have something another person needs. So you might have food and clothing, and extra food and clothing. Another person doesn't have food and clothing. So you have something that you need, they need, and you extend to them something that they need that you have. So it implies that you have something that they need. It also might imply not necessarily a material thing like food or clothing, but kind of bringing together this idea of you have something they need, and you're in a position of power over them, it really brings it to the idea of forgiveness. So you have power over that person. Someone has sinned against you, And when someone sins against you, you have a type of moral power over that person. They did something wrong to you. So think about this in a marriage relationship. Your husband or your wife does something wrong to you. They offend you in some way. And now you have some kind of relational capital over them. You can bring it up. You know, well, so I've heard of couples before. The husband goes out and spends money that he shouldn't spend. And so the wife drives home in a new car, knowing they can't afford it. And her excuse is, well, you spent money we couldn't afford, so I spent money we couldn't afford. Well, now they're just more in debt than they were in the first place. And so there's this idea of, what am I going to do with my spouse went out and spent money that we didn't agree upon. My spouse has sinned against me. So I have some power over them. How am I going to use that power? And what am I going to do with that power? Well, Jesus says, if you want to receive mercy, then you extend mercy. If you want to be blessed, if you want to live in that blessed state, that place of true joy and happiness, then what do? You extend mercy. So blessed are the merciful. It is particularly important. I think you can be merciful to people that don't necessarily owe you something. You can be generally compassionate towards people who you don't necessarily have any power over. But I think it is particularly important to be merciful to people that you have some kind of power over, or in some way they put themselves in a position where they owe you. Blessed are the merciful. Why? For they shall receive mercy. Now, you might read this and think, well, if I'm nice to other people, they'll be nice to me. How does that work out, by the way? It doesn't work out real well. You can be, you know, how many of you have ever said, you know what, I'm going to extend forgiveness to somebody, and then if I extend forgiveness to them and I forgive them, then everything will be good in our relationship, and down the road they won't hold things against me. They'll let things go against me. You know, you can even think about this in marriage. I've sat with couples and counseled them before and said, you know, you need to forgive him. And to have the wife say, I can't. Well, why can't you? Because he will not forgive me over something I did, you know, 2 years ago. So I'm not going to forgive him because he didn't forgive me. Well, that's not what the Bible says. The Bible says you have to forgive him. That's between you and God. His lack of forgiveness for you is between him and God. You've got to be right with God. And in order to be right with God, you've got to extend forgiveness to him. But you've based your forgiveness off of his actions. Well, if I am merciful to him, then maybe he'll be merciful to me. But now that I see he's not going to be merciful to me, then I'm going to withhold mercy from him. That is not what Jesus is talking about. That if you'll be merciful to other people, then they'll be merciful back to you. That's not what he's talking about. He's saying, if you are merciful to other people, then you and I, we will receive mercy from God. This is mercy that comes from God. And here's the thing. If you want to be right with other people, and if you want other people to give you mercy, that's great. And people can give you other people can give you mercy. They might have some power over you. You might owe them something. You might have wronged them in some way, and they have some kind of power over you. And it's good when that person, say the policeman, has some power over you. You've violated the speed limit, and that policeman has some power, and it's good when that policeman shows you mercy. But how much more the God of heaven? The God of heaven has power over us. He is the ultimate power over the universe, and what happens to us is most determined by what God does with us and does for us and does to us. And so, do you want to receive mercy from other people, or do you want to receive mercy from God? And if you receive mercy from God, there's really no other mercy that you need. God can supply to you all of the mercy because God has all of the power. And everything that you owe to him. Even when you sin against someone else, your primary obligation is still to God. Remember David, adultery and murder. I mean, he murdered a man. And in his statement in Psalm 51 is to the Lord, against you and you only have I sinned. How can David say that? How can David say that I didn't sin primarily against Uriah? I sinned against God, even though he murdered Uriah. Here's the reason. Uriah never had a law that said, thou shalt not murder. That's not Uriah's law. Uriah didn't have a law, you shall not commit adultery. He did not break Uriah's laws. He broke God's laws. So primarily and mostly, he sinned against God. So he needs mercy from God. Every sin we've ever committed, even if it does impact some other person in some way, even if it was a sin against some other person, primarily that sin's against God. So all the sins we've ever committed against our spouse, against another person, all of them are really ultimately against God. So when we receive mercy from another person, that's good. But when we receive mercy from God, God is releasing his right to punish us for our sins that we've committed against him. And there is no greater mercy than mercy that comes from God. So they shall receive mercy. You can let your brother or sister or your neighbor or your spouse, you can let them off the hook. Why? Because you have a greater mercy to obtain. There is a greater mercy for you when you are showing mercy to others. And this is not mercy that it is mercy you receive now. His mercies are new every day. We receive mercy from God all the time. But this is ultimately when we stand before God in judgment, we will receive mercy and not punishment. And that is the most important moment in all of our existence. It's when we stand before the Lord, what do we receive? Do we receive what we deserve for our sins, what we have owed, and do we pay the debt that we owe, or is it paid on our behalf? Do we receive mercy? You know, I think back to sitting in that truck and thinking about how nervous I was. I did not want to look at that guy. I mean, I just looked straight ahead. All I wanted to do was get my buddy and say, you talked me into this, and I didn't even get to fish, and you caught the, you know, like I did not want to look over at that farmer because, it's a moment. You've been caught. Can you imagine standing before the Lord and having the Lord say to you, this is the sin you've committed, and there's no place to hide there. There's no justification. Doesn't matter what you say. The Lord sees through all of that. You might be able to convince your friends. You might be able to convince yourself. You might be able to convince the judge. You might be able to talk your way out of a ticket. When you stand before the Lord, the eyes of fire, it burns all that away, and there you are, and there's your sin. In that moment, that's when I want mercy. That's when I want mercy and grace. If someone on earth refuses to extend it to me, I'm going to be okay. But if in that moment, if it's not for the mercy of God, I am eternally lost with no hope. So, blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain, they shall receive mercy. Jesus says this the opposite way in Matthew 7:2. This is one of the most quoted Bible verses now in the 21st century. It used to be John 3:16. Everybody knew John 3:16. It would shock you how few people 30 years old and younger know John 3:16. They've never even heard it. If you start speaking to people, especially outside of the cultural South, and you ask them about it, they've never heard that verse. But they know this verse, or some version of it. Judge not. They know that. Judge not, that you be not judged. That's Matthew 7:1. And then Matthew 7:2 is, for with the judgment you pronounce, you will be judged. And with the measure you use it, it will be measured to you. So this is the negative side of blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. So this is unblessed are the unmerciful, for they shall not receive mercy. And so this is a theme that Jesus uses throughout the Sermon on the Mount and throughout his teaching. Then he gets really explicit in Matthew 6:14 when he's talking about the Lord's Prayer. In fact, he says the entire reason that he taught them to pray the Lord's Prayer in the way that he prayed it is for this reason, verse 14. For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Now, we're all good Baptists in this room, and we hear that and we go, but wait a second. You know, but doesn't, you know, what does this say about our eternal security? You know what? But here's the thing. And when we read this, we want to say, well, now what Jesus was doing was trying to teach us, you know, but here's one thing I don't ever want to do as a teacher of the word. I don't ever want to come along and try to tell you what Jesus was trying to do or what Jesus meant to say. Look, Jesus said what he said. If you withhold forgiveness from others, forgiveness will be withheld from you. Now, are there some ways that we can look at that in light of what Jesus taught in his overall ministry and what in light of what the entire New Testament teaches? Yes, but in that moment, Jesus meant for this to be a sharp cutting statement. It's that serious. If you withhold forgiveness from others, God will withhold forgiveness from you. Period. Jesus moves on to the next topic. He means for that to hit us just the way that it does. Withholding mercy from other people is a serious thing. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. You know, you can try to live by pulling out of others what they owe to you. You owe me something because you sinned against me, so I'm not going to forgive you. I'm going to hold this against you so that I can get whatever I need emotionally, whatever emotional need I have, whatever relational need I have. Maybe if you have relational power. I was counseling a couple one time where the husband had an affair. He had committed adultery against his wife and ultimately against the Lord. And he got caught. There was no question about it. They're sitting in the office and we're talking through this. And I could see in the relationship, even in the body language, the husband was there, rightfully so, head down, shoulder slumped, and he's here, rightfully so. He's been caught in sin. He needs to be sorrowful over his sin. But the wife's posture, her physical posture, was up and it was over the man. And here's, and through counseling, what I found out was the wife was almost thankful that her husband had committed adultery, because she had been trying to get the upper hand in the relationship for years, and now she had it. And she wanted to use it to manipulate and move the relationship in the direction she wanted to move it in. Now, this is a beautiful story, because once we saw that, and once she saw it in herself. It broke her. So now we've gone from one sinner in the room who's broken over his sin to two sinners in the room who are broken over their sin. And there was real reconciliation. And about 2 weeks ago, this has been over a decade, about 2 weeks ago, I saw their anniversary picture come through on social media. And it just made my heart smile, because I remember that moment where their marriage was almost over. She wanted to stay in the marriage. He wanted out. And the reason he wanted out is because now she was going to dominate him relationally, and she was going to manipulate the relationship, and he didn't want to stay in the marriage. But now that they came to the point where they realized, well, they both had sin in this. She's withholding mercy from him. Once she extended mercy to him, then the healing process was able to start. So blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy. You can try to pull something out of somebody that they owe you, or you can extend to them something that they do not deserve. Now, why would we do that? We would do that for two reasons. First, because God told us, if you're merciful, you'll receive mercy. If you withhold judgment, that doesn't mean we don't look at people's lives and see where they are with the Lord. We are fruit inspectors, but we don't put ourselves in the seat of God and serve as judges. No, we extend mercy. And so we can do it because we know if we do that, then God will take that posture with us. He'll extend mercy to us. But there's another reason. We're thinking about future mercy, that we'll stand at the judgment and God will extend mercy to us. But there's another reason. Matthew 18 gives us another reason. Why would we extend mercy to other people? It's because of the mercy that's already been extended to us. And that the mercy that's been extended to us is massive compared to the mercy that we would extend to anybody else. So a spouse who has an affair, commits adultery, the mercy that it takes to forgive that person is nothing compared to the mercy that's been extended to every single child of God who's been forgiven and brought into the family of God. So Jesus tells a story there in Matthew chapter 18. Peter, he comes to him, you probably remember this moment. Peter comes to him and says, "How often should I forgive my brother?" And I was thinking seven times. And Peter thinks he's said something really good. And look, we like to laugh at Peter, but let's think about this. Imagine you're in your pastor's study, you're in your pastor's office, and your husband's in there, and you say, "Pastor, I'm here, I'd like to forgive my husband. He has committed adultery. How many times should I forgive him for committing adultery?" Do you think seven times is reasonable? Does that make me seem like a very merciful person? Well, I think any one of us would say, any wife who forgives her husband seven times for committing adultery is a very merciful wife. So we knock Peter on this. We say, "Well, my goodness, he was trying to be, you know." But look, seven times is a lot. Think about it. A real sin against you. Someone who steals something from you. Someone who wronged you in some way. And you say, "Well, I'll forgive him up to seven times." That's pretty significant. Jesus says, "You got it all wrong. It's not seven times. It's seven times 70. or as many times. It's really a way to say infinitely many times. How many ever times your brother comes to you in true repentance, you should forgive him. That doesn't mean you'll keep him on your, you know, in your business as your partner. You may sever that partnership, but you will extend forgiveness to him. Why? And then he tells this story. He says there was a man who owed a lot of money. The judge forgave him of that money. In fact, the amount of money that he owed is equal to the entire tax burden of the region of Palestine for a year. So imagine all the federal taxes paid in the state of Alabama, and you steal all those, and you are going to big time prison. And the judge says, you know what? We're going to forgive it all. And then this man walks out, and he finds someone who owes him $50. And he says to that person, you owe me the $50. The guy says, I don't have the $50. And he says, well, you're going to prison until you pay me every dime that you owe me. Well, that's the story that Jesus told. And then the judge hears about it and brings the man back in and puts him in prison and says, you're not getting out now. I've removed the mercy that I extended to you. And so Jesus says, the reason that we show mercy is not just because of future mercy, but because we've already received it. So to wrap this up, when you forgive someone, you do not forgive them because they deserve to be forgiven. We forgive them as followers of Christ because we were forgiven when we did not deserve to be forgiven. Amen. We forgive them because Jesus did for us that very same thing. And so we're compassionate and we're merciful towards people, not because they deserve mercy. If they deserve mercy, it is no longer mercy. We are merciful to people precisely because they don't deserve it. And we have received unimaginable mercy from the God of the universe. And it frees us. We are free to extend mercy. The rest of the world, those who don't follow Christ, they are trapped. They can't extend this kind of mercy because they can't imagine this kind of mercy. But when we understand what God has done for us in Jesus, we are free to forgive. We're free to show mercy. We're free to be merciful to people who don't deserve it, people who may never deserve it. We are free to extend it to them. And because of that, we are blessed. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy.